This is Wheeler Dealers, where we're hard at work on one of my favourite classic sports cars, the voluptuous Volvo P1800. I was bowled over by the driving experience. This car is a cracker. But Ed still had plenty to keep his hands dirty in the workshop. Bad valve damage meant the whole cylinder head had to be sent off to be reworked. Then Ed discovered the fuel gauge was kaput. The centre unit had given up the ghost and the tank was full of holes. No wonder the interior stank of petrol. And there's more work ahead for Mr. China. Much more.
Now, Mike was a bit concerned about the rust on the underside of our P1800, and to be honest, when I first looked underneath myself, it did look a little bit dodgy. But on closer inspection, this is quite a chunky bit of metal here. This cross member was obviously built to last. And actually, the rust that you can see is really just surface rust, where the paint has been scraped away by speed bumps and whatever, and clearly that's what this big dent is all about as well. There's nothing really wrong as far as an MOT failure is concerned, but what is a problem, of course, is when a buyer comes to have a look at this car, they're going to see this and be a bit worried about that ding. So what I can do is try and straighten that bit of damage there, kind of rub back some of that rust, and then give it a nice bit of paint.
This might look a bit drastic, but actually it's a quick and easy fix. My oxyacetylene torch heats the mild steel up to around 600 degrees. Then a pair of grips is all I need to give this panel a tweak. I'm not going for perfection, that would be too hard to achieve. I just want it to look a little bit straighter. And to make it look that bit better, I'm also blowing it over with some standard black stone chip paint from a 10-pound aerosol can. Cheap, cheerful and effective.
I think you'll agree, that's looking a lot smarter. But while I'm here, while it's up on the ramp, I'm just going to check for any more areas of rust or damage. Well, this side seems pretty good, actually, except perhaps the shock absorber, which is a bit rusty, but it's not leaking, so it's not an MOT failure. Well, this side seems good. Again, the shock absorber's a little bit rusty. Oh, wow. Now, that is pretty serious. The spring is actually broken. It's kind of sheared in two. It does sometimes happen, so I'm going to have to fix it.
That wasn't in the plan. The suspension spring has snapped clean through. As well as being a real danger on the road, with the potential to affect the car's handling, it's now going to cost me time and money to replace.
To get this broken spring off, I need to disconnect quite a bit of the suspension. I need to undo this drop link here for the anti-roll bar. I need to undo the ball joint at the bottom here on the end of the A-arm here. And also need to disconnect the bolt that holds the shock absorber to this bottom arm. Not too tricky, but loads of things to undo.
This is the sort of work you can do at home. Swapping a shock absorber yourself will save you around £50 a side in labour. I'm using my transmission jack to release the tension on the suspension so I can safely undo all of the bolts. I need the disc brake assembly out of the way, so a bungee cord lifts it up and gives me access to the cracked spring.
Oh, there we go. The spring is out. You can see it's actually broken clean in two. Doesn't happen that often, but when it does, it means we need a new spring. Now, I'm wrestling with the shock absorber because I thought I might as well change that rusty old bit of metal while I'm doing the springs. The thing is, I can't get the nut undone on the top because it's been there for so long. So I think I'm just going to cut it off.
My angle grinder makes short work of the rusted nut and the shock absorber is free. The new shock absorber is an easy fit. Just locate it, pop on the rubber spacer, and then lock it into place with a nut. The spring is a little more fiddly. Once again, I'm using my jack so I can release the tension on the assembly and connect up all the right nuts and bolts. With the near side done, I'm moving over to swap the offside too. It is a really good idea to replace the springs and shocks on both sides at the same time. It gives you peace of mind and means the handling is a bit more predictable. All in, the parts were £100.
Replacing the springs and the shock absorbers was certainly not a job I was expecting to have to do, but now it's done, at least the car will sail through an MOT, and of course with it all looking nice and shiny, it should be easier to sell, and it's even going to handle a little bit better as well. Job done.
This is a real film star of a car. The saint, Simon Templar, would be happy to be behind the wheel of this 60s classic. Ed has played a blinder. The hunt for a decent car was hard, but eventually I was in the right place at the right time to land this original 5 grand car. Valve damage meant the cylinder head needed specialist care, and we opted to have the whole head converted to run on 21st century unleaded petrol. The underside of the car needed a little remedial work, but was soon looking spick and span. Less so, the front coil, which had snapped clean through. Ed replaced the front suspension parts, and now she rides easy on the road. The whole fuel system had seen better days, so the gauge, centre unit and petrol tank were all replaced, and now that high-octane smell in the cabin is a thing of the past. And that should have been that, but the old carburettors were in poor condition, and Ed needed to give them a complete rebuild before the engine would finally run sweetly. So, what's the damage on our vintage Volvo? Well, we bought a bargain and then kept quite a good hold on the purse strings. The fuel system rebuild cost the most in parts, and the cylinder head work cost a few quid too. Amazingly, the total bill for our P1800 came to just under £5,800. And if I can't make a big profit on that, then I'm going to chuck it all in and go back to the paper round. Click here to subscribe.